pray for Hannah's baby, had open heart surgery. Pray for her mother. Pray for Sean Osgood. He comes to church here some. His mother is in the hospital with pneumonia.
Yes.
And so we want to be praying for, is her name Cindy? Is that what you said?
Cindy,
yeah. Cindy Osgood. We want to be praying for them. Yes, ma'am.
I wasn't here Sunday because I was gone. My cousin's husband died, and she called me a while ago, just devastated. Her father has had a real bad stroke today, and they did not think he would survive. And her name is Carol Hale.
All right.
That family needs a lot of prayer.
We want to pray for that family. Pray for my family with my uncle that passed away. Pray for Bonnie. Was Trevor's last name Gearhart, or was it something else?
It was Gearhart.
Okay. Bonnie Gearhart, Trevor's wife. He passed away. She's like 20, has a one-year-old child, and already a widow. We want to be praying for her, praying for that family, and that's salvation. I got to go to her house the other day and prayed with her, led her in a prayer of salvation, and just praying, Lord, let it stick, let it be something that's it's there. And so we do want to pray for them. And I know the Malden family, they had a loved one that passed away. We took up an offering on that. I'm still waiting to hear from the funeral home with them. All right, David's brother,
Richard,
possible blood clot in his lungs. And let's pray for him. Yes, ma'am. Let's pray for the Balance's family. We got several needs there. Yes, sir. Yes, new job. New job. No, you cannot. We're on a timeline here. Go ahead. Good. How do we know God does that?
Yep.
He responds to our faith. And so we are praying for Shauna to adapt well to her new job. And we need to pray for those people at her job. You know, Shauna Ashcraft is coming in the building. So we need to pray for those people. So yeah, they're married. They finally get to live together. Isn't that wonderful? That's wonderful. They get married and then shake hands and wave at each other as they go their two different directions. So that's awesome. All right. Yes. Yes. All right. Pray for a new job. Yes, ma'am. God has this. We're going to pray that God has this.
Well, not just that, but she has three children that have come here with her a couple of times, and they
Yeah.
Just pray that when she gets where she needs to be, that those kids are so angry at her, but they want to see that she means what she's saying.
Yeah.
Just pray for God to restore that relationship.
Yes. All right. Let's pray that way. Yes, sir.
Brother Ivy had a gallbladder operation today.
Okay.
All
right. Let's pray for Brother Ivy. Got it. Recover him. Yes, ma'am. Okay. All right. Healing from migraine issues, asking God to heal that. Yes, ma'am.
Remember our oldest daughter, the one that laid out the Holy Spirit? About 3 weeks ago, she had a break on her youngest daughter's bicycle, and she hit the ground. She couldn't even remember what day it was or nothing like that. So they don't know if she's having blackouts, seizures.
Okay.
And they said she suffered from a concussion. But she's got to go to children's. We just got a letter today. She's got to go have two tests done. It's a neuropsychologist test and another test done the same day.
Okay.
To find out what's going on.
Okay.
And so her name is Lana.
Lana?
Yeah.
Okay. Let's remember Lana in prayer. However, you have unspoken needs, things just near and dear on your heart. I think we all do. Well, then let's pray. But as we pray, you have to pray believing. You have to pray that God is hearing and He's going to do something about it. So, Father God, we link our faith together, because I know sometimes faith is hard. Sometimes when you're going through a dry spot, a tough spot, sometimes it's difficult. So, Father, right now, we link our faith together and we lay all of these needs boldly at your feet. And Lord God, we know that you are the healing God. So we speak over the physical bodies, the infirmities right now. And God, we pray right now over these infirmities. Be healed in Jesus' name. God, restore health to the body. Lord, we speak peace to the mind as well. Let there be peace in our minds and our emotions. That, Lord God, we are not carried away by emotion, but we are stable on the fact, Lord God, that you are the Lord. Father, we lay our families at your feet. Lord God, our relationships, those things that have got to be put back together. Lord, we believe you for it right now, that you administer throughout our families and take care of them. That, Lord God, you see those that need help in jobs or at a new job. And Father, I pray right now, begin ministering in such a way, as Billy Ray was saying, in such a way that it proves that you still work, you still move according to these things. Lord God, we pray over those that are grieving over lost loved ones. And we ask right now, Lord Jesus, that you would restore the heart, restore the mind. And Lord God, let people be at peace because they know that you're in control, that you're on the move. And Father, we pray that you would bring a peace to their heart and mind. And Lord God, let healing come in, that we can get past our grief and get on with life. God, we pray for our lost loved ones that don't know you as Savior. And we pray right now, Lord God, that you would move as we called out their names, as we are standing in the gap for them. We are believing for salvation right now for these, Lord God, of our families that do not know you. And Lord, I bring before you our Sunday services for the next couple weeks. And God, just as you have been leading people into salvation, we've been seeing them being baptized in the Holy Spirit. Father, we're praying right now for the next two Sundays, two Easter Sundays, Lord God, that we're going to have Palm Sunday and Easter Sunday. And God, I'm declaring for the house to be filled. Come on, somebody, agree with me. Lord, bring in those that need salvation. And God, we're going to believe that we're going to see some people get saved over the next two Sundays. But Lord, we're also going to see those that are going to get the seed planted in their heart, that Lord Jesus, that will become saved. That God, it's that first touch that's going to lead to a final prayer. And Lord God, we pray right now, bring them in, put them in our path so we can invite them. God, keep doing something beautiful here. And God, we just lay all these needs at your feet, and we just say, thank you, Lord God. We're not going to worry about it. We're not going to fret about it. We're not going to fight about it. But we know that you're in control. And God, we just give you the glory, the praise, and the honor right now. In Jesus' name, and somebody that believes says amen.
Amen.
Amen. Hallelujah. Turn with me, if you would, in your Bibles to 1 Corinthians chapter 3 and 1 Corinthians chapter 16. Two places there in 1 Corinthians chapters 3 and chapter 16. A message that was really heavy on my heart at the first of the week to bring for today, and I don't know, I'm still measuring it right now when we have our community service. I may even be bringing this one, and you'll see why in just a moment. But those of you that are taking notes, the title of this lesson here is called Play the Man. I want you to, these three words I want you to grasp hold of. You're going to understand why it's important. Three words: play the man. Play the man. There is in England, there's a cross in the road on Broad Street. It's in Oxford, England, not far from Balliol College. And it marks the site of an execution that took place a long time ago. Workmen, some years back in the 1800s, they were clearing things away. And as some workmen were working on a road, and there's was a large ditch in that area, as they're clearing some stuff away, they actually found a post, a stake that had been burnt down to an area, to a small being, and there was chips, fragments of burnt bone that was gathered around this stake. And when they began to research what had happened right here at Oxford, in which is not just the town, but you also have a Bible college called Oxford Divinity School was right there. And they began to do their research and found out that there was an execution had taken place on that spot some 200 years prior. It's known as the Oxford Martyrs Memorial. It's there right now. The memorial was put up 1840, somewhere around there. So it's the marker is old, but it commemorates a spot. And I want you to hear how I say this. It commemorates the death of two incredible elder statesmen of the church at the hands of smaller-souled, lesser men of the church. Okay? So you got two men of the church who are great men of God who were burned at the stake by lesser people within the church. Now, this was during the 16th century, back in the 1500s, and during that time in England, King Henry VIII was the king at the time, and he had worked to separate. The Catholic Church was the big church of the realm, and up until this point, you've been having some division. There was groups that were trying to pull away from the Catholic Church and what we know of as the Reformation. Anybody ever heard of a guy named Martin Luther? Martin Luther, about that, little before this, Martin Luther had pulled away. He had nailed his 95 theses on the door at Wittenberg, saying, "Why we will not be Catholic anymore. This is how we know that we are saved alone, by faith alone, in Christ alone, that we don't have to go to confess to a man. We don't have to pay money to the church in order to get saved. You owe your faith to the Reformation." Okay, our roots go back to this time. So in the 16th century, you got a guy by the name of King Henry VIII. King Henry says, "All right, I am for the Church of England, which is Protestant, us. You're either one of two things, you're Protestant or you're Catholic." King Henry says, "We're not going to be a Catholic nation anymore." So he pulls the Church of England out, puts it at the forefront, moves the Catholic Church to the back, and says, this is who we're going to be. Now, he's a king. He's not a theologian. He's not a priest. He just makes a statement, says, "We're not going to burn anybody at the stake for not being Catholic." But he didn't change all the practices, all the beliefs, but he's working on it. Well, King Henry dies, and he has a son named Edward. King Edward comes into being as the king. He takes up daddy's roles, and he starts moving it forward as well. He's promoting. So you got through two kings, you've got both of them saying, "Hey, the Church of England is the way. Catholic Church, we're just going to set it aside because we don't want to kill anybody anymore." Now, bear in mind that both kings did put a lot of people to death. They just weren't as bad as what was about to come. Now, Edward's advisors had told him, keep pushing the Church of England forward, and let's make this a Bible-based Christianity. So as they're moving it that way, you have two men that come upon the scene. There's two guys that I want to focus on. One of them is named Nicholas Ridley, and the other one is Hugh Latimer. Nicholas Ridley and Hugh Latimer. Both of these men would wind up becoming great proponents of this Bible-based way of having church versus, and understand, at that time in the Catholic realm, you couldn't own a Bible. That was for the priest, that was for the church. The common man couldn't have a Bible, and the Bibles that they did have were all in Latin. Latin was a dead language. Nobody but the church and maybe some high government areas actually used Latin. The common man did not use Latin. It was not uncommon that you'd have a Latin service and people would be sitting there. They're just in church because they know they need to have church, but they can't speak Latin. And so what the Church of England was doing was, every man needs to believe in Jesus Christ for his salvation, not a pope, not a priest, and every man needs to have a copy of the Word of God. If you've ever heard of a man named John Huss, John Knox, William Tyndale, these three men, among others, were all burned at the stake by the Catholic Church, and I'm not here to bash on the Catholic Church, but we're heading somewhere here today. All three of these men were burned at the stake by the Catholic Church because they believed every man should have a Bible in the English language or in their own language. And they were burned at the stake by that. Hugh Latimer and Nicholas Ridley would become Bible scholars teaching people how to live for Jesus Christ. Now Nicholas Ridley was a chaplain to King Henry VIII. That's a pretty incredible title. He was also the Bishop of London under his son, King Edward. So here's a guy that preached to the higher-ups. He had a pretty good congregation of his own, and his own life portrayed what his doctrine was. It's kind of refreshing if you have a pastor and he actually believes or lives what he preaches. Hallelujah. So here's a guy who's living out what he says. He is an example to those around him. Imitate me as I imitate Christ. And he's a huge proponent in people having daily Bible readings and not just read your own Bible, which was a novelty. Again, you could be put to death not long in the recent past. You could be put to death for it. He says, read your own Bible and memorize Scripture. You need to be able to do Scripture memorization. Hugh Latimer, who was a little younger than Nicholas Ridley, had become an influential preacher during King Edward, the son, during his reign, earnest student of the Bible, became known as the Bishop of Worcester, and he encouraged people, get into the Word of God, study the Word of God. Both of these men were very public in hey, we got free reign, we're not worried about being put to death, get in the Word of God, study it, learn who your Savior is. He emphasized that you serve the Lord with a true heart, an inward affection, and it's not just an outward show. He was very critical of those that had an outward religion while they were inside full of dead men's bones. And he was known for his good works. He'd go to prisons, and he would minister to those that were in the jail. Now, let's fast forward a little bit. King Henry's dead. Edward's on the throne. Edward dies. He has a daughter named Mary. Anybody remember Bloody Mary? Queen Mary, also known as Mary of Scots, she became the Queen of England, and it became her mission to take the Catholic Church off the back burner and put it up towards the front. Now, to be fair to Mary, Mary put a lot of people to death. So did her father and her grandfather. The difference was the people Mary was putting to death happened to be church people. The predominance of it was people from the Church of England. One of her first actions as queen was to get hold of a couple guys, Bishop Ridley and Bishop Latimer. She grabbed another guy by the name of Archbishop Thomas Cranmer. And we're not going to talk about him. He suffered sort of the same fate later on, but I want to focus on Ridley and Latimer. Both of these men were put into the Tower of London. They were held in jail for 2 years. And studying their Bible, trying to get letters written out, kind of like Paul, so they can encourage people while they're in there. Well, in September of 1555, they got the call that both of these men were going to be brought to Oxford. And there at Oxford, they were going to face a tribunal called the Lord's Commissioner. And there, they were going to be tried according to the Catholic faith. Well, everybody knew who these men were. Everybody knew that they were not for the Catholic Church. They were for every man being saved by faith alone in God, not by works, that they were going to, every man should have a Bible. Well, it didn't take long for them to get the death sentence. And so it came down that they were condemned to death by fire at the stake. So on October the 16th, 1555, both men were led to this place there in Oxford. And they were both tied to a stake. They each one had a stake next to each other. They were back to back. And in order to make it a little more lenient, they'd actually tied sacks of gunpowder around their neck. So eventually, instead of just a slow burn, that would catch on fire and end them a little bit quicker. Interesting thing happened. I'm not going to get in the gory details of it. But as Bishop Ridley, he's the older man, as he was being led, both of them were led up to their post. Both of them knelt down, took hold of the stakes that they're going to be tied to, kissed them, prayed, got up, and began to be tied. Bishop Ridley, when he was being tied, he looked at the executioner and he said this, "Tie my bonds tightly. I do not want to leave my post at the moment of trial." How many of you have ever been in the midst of a hard time saying, "God, bail me out of this right now"?
Yeah.
Tie my bonds tightly. I do not want to leave my post at the moment of trial. I want to stay. Ridley then prayed and said, "O Heavenly Father, I give unto thee my most hearty thanks that thou hast called me to be a professor of thee even unto death. Thank you for calling me to be a Bible teacher, even though it's going to cost me my life. I beseech thee, Lord God, have mercy on this realm of England and deliver her from all of her enemies." At that point, Latimer, who was tied next to him or behind him, heard his prayer, called out. Now, this is actually a famous quote that you can Google and you can find it. Bishop Latimer encouraged his senior bishop with these words, "Be of good comfort, Mr. Ridley, and play the man. Be of good comfort, Mr. Ridley, and play the man. We shall this day light such a candle by God's grace." Think about that. They're going to be set on fire, and he's calling himself a candle. "We are going to light a candle by God's grace in England, as I trust shall never be put out." Now, in order to do this justice, I need to do a little translation work. 16th century English is not the same as 21st century English. What Mr. Latimer was saying when he called out to Mr. Ridley was this: "Be of good cheer, Mr. Ridley, and act like a man. Be of good cheer, Mr. Ridley, and play the man. Act like a man." That's how we would translate it. This was actually the usage of a phrase that you would find three times in the Old Testament. But the best place that you're going to see this used in the Word of God is actually found in 1 Corinthians chapter 16. Turn with me in your Bibles there. In 1 Corinthians chapter 16, verse 13, I'm reading from the New American Standard. Some may read a little bit different from this. But this is how the Bible says this. 1 Corinthians 16, verse 13 says, "Be on the alert, stand firm in the faith, act like men. Be strong, and let all that you would do be done in love." Five things that a man needs to do. Five things that he's talking to Christian men, talking to Christian people. He's telling them five things that need to be done. Be on the alert. Stand firm in the faith. Act like men. That's where when Mr. Latimer calls out to Bishop Ridley and he says, play the man. That's literally a part of this verse right here where he says, standing firm in the faith, act like men. And be strong and let everything you do be done in love. Now, let's go back a little further. Let's go back to Paul's day in the city of Corinth. When Paul wrote the letter of 1 Corinthians that we read from, keep your Bibles open there because we're going to see this again, 1 Corinthians chapter 16 as well as chapter 3. When Paul wrote this letter to the Corinthian church, it was to address some serious doctrinal issues. Some people were misbehaving. They weren't doing right. And so he wrote this letter to this church that he had actually founded on his second missionary journey as he went through there. He founded the church, spent time with the church, worked with the church, preached in the church, led the church into the baptism of the Holy Spirit, led them into the gifts of the Spirit, left. And as he is gone doing his work, he gets word back that the people were not doing right. They were misbehaving. So he writes this letter. Now, the Roman colony of Corinth is actually, in Paul's day, it was a strategic seaport. I didn't have enough time or else I'd have all the neat pictures for you to see all this. Corinth was actually a seaport town. And because it was on a seaport, it was full of commerce. It was full of prosperity. It was full of luxury. And because of that, it was full of immorality. If you're going to have all this riches and luxury, you're going to have a lot of immorality. In that time period, there was a saying called to live like a Corinthian. Paul talks about in one of his letters, talking about the people of Crete, how it says, you've heard it said that all Cretans are lazy. And you'll read that in some of Paul's writings. I think it's to it's either to Timothy or to Titus. He talks about the people of Crete, how they're lazy, how they're no good. Well, there in that same time period was a saying that said, to live like a Corinthian. Oh, you live like a Corinthian. Oh, you're acting like a Corinthian. To say that meant that that person lived in gross immorality. I mean, they just messed around. And it's typically that their misbehavior was through money, sex, power, or idolatry. One or a multiple of these things was where they were misbehaving. Oh, man, you're acting like a Corinthian. When Paul addresses, you'll find in 1 Corinthians chapters 12 and 14, those of you, you've heard me talk about this plenty of times, 1 Corinthians 12 and 14 actually deal with the gifts of the Spirit, the laying on of hands, the healing, gifts of knowledge, gifts of wisdom, speaking in tongues, interpretation of tongues, all these different gifts. Now, when Paul is in this same book and he's talking about these different gifts of the Spirit, it shows that powerful things had already been happening in that church while Paul was there. And just like it was in the book of Acts. So in the book of Acts, people were getting healed. They were in Corinth as well. People were being baptized in the Holy Spirit. They were in Corinth as well. So you find that these things were happening. However, even though the dynamic power of God was operating among them, they were misbehaving. How do you know just because you get baptized in the Holy Spirit doesn't mean you're going to behave?
That's right.
Now, why does God give the gift? Because God's trying to help you step up your life in Him. Mm-hmm. That's why the Bible says, go back and look at Matthew chapter 25. Matthew chapter 25 is three parables of where the church misses it. It says that the Messiah is coming back, and in all three of those, you'll see three parables where it talks about the sheep and the goats, and those who said, Lord, when were you naked and we didn't know you? And he says, depart from me, worker of iniquity. If you didn't do it for them, you didn't do it for me. Three times, three parables, the church missed it, and they're going to miss heaven. One of those times is where it says, but Lord, Lord, did we not cast out demons in your name? Did we not do these supernatural things in your name? And what does Jesus say to them? Depart from me. Listen, just because we've been used by God in the Holy Spirit, hear me now, Just because we've been in a Pentecostal dynamic, if we are not truly living for God, or if we make it all about us and not about Him, we depart from the faith, we've got to be in trouble. Listen to me, there's going to be some Assembly of God folk in hell. There is. Because they were invested in the religion and not in the relationship that took place. Just because God spoke through a donkey doesn't mean that's what God wanted to use. God would have spoke to the man if the man would have listened to God, but instead he could only listen to a donkey. There was a moment when God used a rooster to convict Peter. Had a man been available to convict Peter, I think God would have used the man, but instead he had to use a rooster. I believe that if the people hadn't cried out at the triumphal entry and said, "Hail to the King, Hosanna in the highest," had they not done it, what did Jesus say? The rocks would have cried out, listen to me. I earnestly believe had Jesus rode in that day and the people not give glory to God, that you would have started hearing some sandstone start worshiping the Lord Jesus. I believe it. Just because God uses us doesn't mean we are His. That might mess up your theology, but you need to hear me. We have to be very careful that we are living right with God. Just because God uses us doesn't mean He condones how we're living. It just meant we were available at the moment. If you don't believe me, go back and look at the prophet who tried to cast a curse on Israel back in the day of Moses, and he couldn't do it. Every time he looked at him, he had to speak a blessing. Go back and reread that story, and you'll find out that if God's going to do something, God's going to do something, and He'll use what He has at hand. Now, the people were misbehaving, even though they had the power among them. The people in Corinth weren't doing right. Paul calls them out in chapter 3 in what we would know as a precursor to denominational wars that we fight today. In chapter 3, 1 Corinthians, it says this, verse 1. "And I, brethren, could not speak to you as spiritual men, but as to men of the flesh, as to infants in Christ." If you've ever got mad at a preacher because you felt like he was talking down to you, if you ever got mad at a preacher because they preached a sermon that hurt your feelings, I'm telling you, you would have got spitting mad at Paul at this moment. Paul says, "I was among you, I pastored you, I helped you get the moving of the Holy Spirit in your church, I helped establish you, and you ought to be men of God. But you're so bad, I got to talk to you like you're a bunch of babies." I guarantee the offering wouldn't be that good come Sunday if I preach this message. It'd be tough. He says, "I ought to speak to you as men, but now I'm having to talk to you like infants." Verse 2. "I gave you milk to drink, not solid food, for you were not able to receive it at that time. Indeed, even now, you're still not able, for you are still fleshly. For since there is jealousy and strife among you, are you not fleshly, and are you not walking like mere men?" Now, if you have the New American Standard, and I think there's a couple others that uses terminology, it's important for that. "I should be talking to you like adults, but because," he says, "there's jealousy and strife among you, you are fleshly, and are you not walking like mere men? For one says, 'I'm of Paul,' and another of Apollos. Are you not mere men?" They're fighting. "Hey, I'm Baptist, I'm Methodist, I'm Pentecostal, I'm mainline," whatever. They're having this argument, and he's saying, "Why are you behaving like this? You've got Jesus in your heart. You got the Holy Spirit moving around you. You are not mere men. You're something more. You're something more." To be a mere man means to be found just as you are, just as you're seen. That, and in the South, we might take that as a compliment. You know, hey, he is who he is. Billy Ray, what you see is what you get. Now, as in the South, we'd say, yeah, that's, you know, we're going to be genuine. That's not what he's saying here. To be mere means to be found without any greater or better quality. That this is make-do carpet. This is Make do bologna. This is just, I didn't know you could have name brand bologna. I thought Oscar Mayer was, you know, name brand meat until I moved to Arkansas. If you want name brand bologna, what brand do you buy? Petagene bologna. Yeah. What was it? What'd you say? Bar S? No, that's, oh my goodness. That's everything left on the bottom of the floor, man. I didn't know you could have name brand bologna till I moved to Arkansas. Man, you got Bar S bologna, but then you got, you know, our great value, but then you got Petagene bologna, man. I can't stand either. I don't like bologna, but that's beside the point. So to be mere means to be average, generic, nothing special. And he says, you're not generic. You're not mere men. You are more. Why? Because you have Christ in your heart and the Holy Spirit moving through you. Why are you behaving like this? And as people of God, we're not perfect. Have you know that? We're not even near perfect. But as Paul says in Philippians chapter 3, I lay hold of him who laid hold of me. I forget what is behind me, and I what? I press forward. I press on. I reach out to get hold of God. I'm moving towards higher things until God calls me home. So that's what God calls us to be. We're not mere people. We're trying to get through this life the best we can for God and to do some great things for God. And yet in chapter 3, Paul tells us, he tells them and us not to be fleshly, not to be jealous, not to be angry, not to be divided, not to be causing strife. Why? Because that's what mere men do. That's what generic people do. That's what the world does. And he's saying, that's not you. You've got Christ. You've got the Holy Spirit. You're something more. And he finishes the whole book by saying how we should live. Chapter 16, verse 13. Be on the alert. Stand firm in the faith. Act like what? Men. Act like grown-ups. Act like men. Be strong and let everything you do be done in what? Love. Be done in love. Do you really think Ridley and Latimer were burned to the stake in love? Do you really believe that? No. Do you know what you find all those centuries later? You find a group of men who are mere men, but they're the leaders of the church. They're so threatened, they're so thin-skinned, they're so offended that not only can they not just argue the point with you or just agree to disagree, they've got to kill you. They've got to kill you because you don't believe like they do. They assassinate because you don't stand with them. Paul says, let everything you do be done in what? Love. Do you know what held those two men to that post that day? It was their love. Their love for God, their love for the Word, their love for the people. That they would allow their life to be done like that. They were going to play the man. They're going to be the man. Now, there's a reason for saying all that. In March 30th of this year, Barna Researchers, a group started by George Barna who does research for churches, put out a publication. I printed it off. I'm not going to read the whole thing to you. But it's called Meet Those Who Love Jesus But Not the Church. Meet Those Who Love Jesus But Not the Church. And in this article, it starts off with this. It says, we live in an increasingly secular American culture. Now, you got a lot of research groups, polling groups out there. Man, they'll tell you all kinds of things. What I appreciate about Barna is in the church, of the church, for the church. They're not out to torture the data to make the church look bad. When Barna talks about the church, it's trying to tell you this is what's going on in the American church today. Now this, and this is just, what, a week old. This is just a week old. We live in an increasingly secular American culture. In this new age, religion is in retreat from the public square, and traditional institutions like the church are no longer functioning with the cultural authority that they once held in generations past. Today, nearly half of America is unchurched. I want you to remember that number right there. Today, nearly half of America is unchurched. It's no longer the authority. It's no longer the thing that people run to in their culture. But even though more and more Americans are abandoning the institutional church and its defined boundary markers of religious identity, many still believe in God and practice faith outside of its walls. Now, of our nation, the South is probably the most religious part of the whole nation. How do you agree with that? If you've ever lived anywhere else, lived out there on the West Coast, if you've lived up in the Northwest, if you lived especially in the Northeast, you find out that, man, the further north or west you go, the colder the flame of God gets. People don't love God, honor the church like we do here in the South, for whatever reason. Go west, young man. Proven fact that as they went west, they took a lot of things with them, but it wasn't the church that they took with them. Now, what's interesting is one of the strongest segments of these who love Jesus but not the church is right here in the South. And I think the reason for that is because the South has more religious people in it, so you're going to notice a little bit more of a swing that way, but it's happening right here in the South more than anywhere else. Half of America, remember that? Half of America do not go to church at all. Now, here in Grant County, where Poyen is located. Some of you may live in another county. Grant County has an 89% favorability rate towards God and the church. That's actually very high. That's a lot higher than the American standard. The America, by and large, does not have a high opinion of the church or God. And while Grant County, 89% of the people who live in Grant County says, we love God, we love the church, 45% of Grant County actually goes to church. 45% of those in our county. That was from a precept study I had done in 2012. And it doesn't get any better. Some of you have heard me use the term called the rate of attrition. The rate of attrition means every year you're going to lose an amount of people. It doesn't matter what church you're at. It doesn't matter where you go. Every church loses people every year. You lose them to death. You lose them to people relocating. You lose them to another church. You lose them because they're mad. You lose them because of all kinds of reasons, okay? It just happens. Every church it happens to. I was listening to a guy by the name of Mark Batterson, pastors of church in Washington, D.C., Washington, D.C. is a constant influx and outgo of people with military, commerce, government, law, industry, all those sorts of things. In their church, which they started out with 19 people, they now run a few thousand. He starts out every year, January 1st, knowing that 40% of his church is going to be gone. The rate of attrition is so high in Washington, D.C. because of job transfers and relocations and military deployments. He's going to lose 40% of his church every year. We in the South in a rural culture like this will lose. We'll lose 10 to 15% of our people. If we run 200, we're going to lose 30 to 40 people a year. We've got to gain in 30 to 40 people just to make up for what we're going to lose this year. I want you to see that. But this is talking about people that leave the church and they never come back. And we would consider, these people would consider themselves spiritual. They appear to practice an active prayer life, yet they're less likely to read their Bible. They're less likely to read Christian literature. They're less likely to attend a retreat. And they would prefer to mix into their religious practices meditation, exercise, and being in nature. This is what they want. Now, they don't desire any kind of authority over them spiritually. Now, stay with me, friends, because we're going somewhere. Stay with me. They don't want any kind of authority over them that says, this is what the Word of God says, this is how we're supposed to live. They don't want anything like that because they feel like I can make my own decisions. But one of the worst things that we find by those who say, I love Jesus, but not the church, is this. Theirs is a private faith. Because it's a private faith, there is zero evangelism that takes place. If we all decided, hey, you know what, let's get married, but we're not going to have kids, how many years would it take before there's a zero population in the world? You have to reproduce. There's got to be a reproduction for things to continue on. Let me finish with this. There's the editor-in-chief of Barna Group is a woman named Roxanne Stone. Roxanne Stone summarizes it for us this way. She's talking to you now, okay? Listen to this. This group represents an important and growing avenue of ministry for the church. This is a ministry field we need to be reaching, she says. Particularly if you live in a more churched area of the country, which we do, it's more likely that you have a significant number of these disaffected Christians in your neighborhood. They still love Jesus, they still believe in Scripture, and most of the tenets of their Christian faith, but they have lost faith in the church. While many people in this group may be suffering from church wounds, if you've never been wounded in a church, hang around, it'll happen. We also know from past research that Christians who do not attend church say it's primarily not out of wounding, but because they can find God elsewhere, or that church is not personally relevant to them. The critical message, and I need you to hear this, the critical message that churches need to offer this group is a reason for churches to exist at all. What is it that the church can offer their faith that they can't get on their own? Churches need to be able to say to these people and to answer for themselves that there is a unique way that you can find God only in church. Because faith does not survive or thrive in solitude. Faith does not thrive in solitude. What does the Bible say? Come together. Work together. Ephesians 4 says, God gave us apostles, prophets, pastors, evangelists, teachers. Gave us these things for what? To build up the body so that the body will work together to do the work. We cannot do this on our own. Look at anybody that tries to do it on their own, and what do you see? They spiral. They don't last. They don't stay. Playing the man for us today means to move beyond ourselves and our selfish natures. It means that there's a much broader world that's got to be reached, and we are better suited if we do that together. But you have these people who say, I love God, but I want nothing to do with the church. You know people like this. You may be related to people like this. And this is a question I have. Number one is Ephesians 5 says that Paul says when Christ died, who did he die for? You'll never find in the Bible where it says Jesus Christ died for Mike Sullivan. Jesus Christ died for David and Kathy Hull. Jesus Christ died for Weta Balance. You'll never find that. But in Ephesians chapter 5, it says, husband, love your wife as Christ loves the and gave himself for her. Christ, Ephesians 5, this is not Mike Sullivan. Ephesians 5 says, Christ died for the church. There's a reason Christ made the church, why he created it. Ridley and Latimer and a host of others, if you have not gotten a copy of Fox's Book of Martyrs, get your hands on a copy of that. Get the updated language so that it doesn't read old-fashioned English. But Ridley and Latimer died that the Church of Jesus Christ would flourish. They died so that the church would be healthy and strong and do good. and that in its endeavor to know God and make Him known, they died so that the church would succeed. What kind of church is that? What kind of a church did they die for? And my question is because I'm very self-inspecting. As good of things that happen in this church, are we a church that they died for? They gave their lives. He gave His life for the church. Are we that kind of church? And let me ask you this. Of all the churches around us, who is that church? Of this church, why is church important? What does this church have to offer that other people need? We've got to ask ourselves these questions, because otherwise we'll never get them in here. We'll never be able to reach them. What is it about our church that would cause people to come in? Why should people belong to us? Come on, think about this. Why should people become a member of this church? Is one brand of church really better than another? Why? I'm for Paul. I'm for Apollos. I'm Baptist. I'm Methodist. I'm Pentecostal. How do you know there is one church, and it's the church of Jesus Christ? Now hear this. Why would a needy soul truly, would a needy soul truly find what they're needing if they walked in this building? Regardless of how they're dressed, what they look like, how they smell, would they feel at home in this church? Now, I love this church, and I kind of think we're a pretty welcoming church. But we got to keep asking ourselves this question. Would somebody come in and feel at home in this place? Would they feel welcome? Would they feel the presence of God? Let me finish with this. I need everybody to look at me. Look at me. Look at me. Look at me. Would you die for this church? Would you die for this church? If so, why? If not, why not? There's a lot of times we'll say, yeah, I'll do until it costs me something. Listen, friend. People have died so that the church would thrive. Jesus Christ gave His life for what? The church. And the worst thing we could do is be mere men, mere women, mere people who say, I want this version. I want that thing. I want that thing. I want to be this person. However, you know, we have got to be a people that's about pleasing Him. Why would God bring people to this church? Would you agree that Jesus loves a sinner? Sure, there is children. Why would God bring them to this church? Why would God want to put them here? Would His children be safe in this church? Would His children find His presence in this church? Would His children find the Spirit in this place? Would His children find liberation from their demons? Would His children find Him in this church? Now, as a pastor, I'd say absolutely. But listen to me, guys. We are one generation away from having an impotent church. We are one generation away from having a church that makes zero difference. We are 1 year away. We are one season away from having a dead church because we quit focusing on Christ and we focused on self. We focused on us. We focused on things other than what Christ wants. We're going to celebrate Easter here pretty quick. Jesus didn't die for carpet color. Jesus didn't die for our arguments, our flesh, our selfishness. That's not what He died for. He died to gather His children together so that together we make a difference. You know why? Because we are better together. The church operates together. It never operates on its own. The church operates together. We have got to stay that church. We have to be a church that not only is Jesus proud to have given his life for, but we would be ready, just like Ridley, just like Latimer, to play the man. I will play the man. I will act like the man. You will act like the man, the woman, the person. You will act the person that stands for who God is and how he desires for us to be. Because I don't know about you. I want Jesus to look at Poyen Assembly of God and say, well done. Good job. You did it. You did it. Any questions? Any? I know it's kind of a heavy word. It's not exactly a stem winder. I know that. This is a medicinal word. This is preventative word. Because I don't know about you guys. I don't ever, ever, ever want to become a dead church. Remember that? We studied that book, The Autopsy of a Deceased Church. I don't want to become a dead church. If we just do what feels natural, we will die. But if we follow him, is somebody hearing me? If we follow him, we will always be a church that God will use, God will bless. And it all starts with you. Will you be that person? Father God, right now, search us. Search us. And Father God, I pray, help us to move beyond our selfishness. Help us to move beyond our flesh. Help us to move beyond our anxieties. Help us to move beyond our fightings. Help us to move beyond these things and say, Lord, let your kingdom come and your will be done in me. Let it be done in me. Let me be more like you so that my church can be more like you. Let me be safe in your hands, Lord God, so people be safe that you put into my hands. Father, I pray that you would search our church. Just like we pray for every other church every week. Search our church, Lord God. And if there's anything wrong in us, then Father, fix it, correct it. And Father, the things that are good, let them be blessed. That Father, we will continue to move on and be a good, solid church because we play the man. We do what is right. And Father, I just thank you. I thank you for the good people of this church. I thank you, Lord God, for how you've done such wonderful stuff here. And what I pray, God, is keep doing it. Somebody agree with me right there, would you? God, keep doing the good things that you do here. It's not because we deserve it. It's because we follow hard after you. And Father, watch over us. Lead us. Convict us where we need convicting, God. We open ourselves up to you. Convict us. If we're in the wrong on anything, convict us and lead us in the right way. And Father, where we are doing good, encourage us so that we do not fall short. Tie our hands, Lord God, to the post so that we will not shirk away from our duty. And Father, we give you glory. We give you praise in Jesus' name. Somebody said amen. 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 I love you guys very much. We're going into Easter season. Easter season's a time of sacrifice. It is a time of self-inspection. Take the next couple of weeks and start looking at yourself, not through your own mean eyes, because you're harder on yourself than the Lord is. But I want you to take a good look at yourself through the eyes of the Holy Spirit and see if you're doing right, if you're living right. And then let's believe for God to really do some resurrecting this coming Easter. God bless you. I love y'all. Have a wonderful evening. Don't forget all the